So, hello guys, welcome to my AutoTools workshop. This workshop will be more of a talk at the beginning, where we will spend like 30 minutes describing you what's the AutoTools, how it works, and how it's supposed to be written. And in the rest of the workshop, we will try to write a build system for one package my coworker showed me that he needs to have fixed. So, let me introduce myself. My name is Tomáš Chvátal, and I work for SUSE since 2011, and I was in QA till the last month, and this month I started in OpenSUSE team with other members, which one of them is present in this room over there. You can see him, at least some of you. So, other than that, I packaged LibreOffice for OpenSUSE and Gentoo, do various stuff for OpenSUSE, like packaging Datovka, which is Czech ESDS communication system with government and things like that. I do some voluntary work for the OpenSUSE, and I'm also a Gentoo developer and Gentoo council member. And as this is workshop, remember to ask your questions right away and do not wait for the end of the talk or the workshop. Just raise your hand and I guess the guys will pass you some microphones so we can put it on record. Okay. So, what the hell is the AutoTools and how does it process its things? So, this graph is a full graph of AutoTools operate. It's pretty insane and you don't need to know most of this thing because if you take a look, we write two files on the left, makefile.m and configure.ac. Those are the files you are supposed to write as a developer. Then, given some magic, we don't care about that now, you generate configure file and makefile in file. As the process is configure, make install to get the package deployed, you run the configure file and it produces two files, config.h and makefile. After that, you run the make and you receive your executable. So, if we move from this to this, I would say this is a bit more straightforward and understandable. So, this is how deploying your AutoTools system looks when you actually are doing it. As a developer, you have some Git repository, you run AutoGen script, which you've written, and it actually configures the, regenerates the configure.ac for your configure script. After that, you can run the configure, and run make this check, which is special command to generate your tarball for the release that you upload somewhere. Then your usual friendly guy who wants to package your library just downloads it, unpacks. Again, he doesn't have to care about the autogen anymore, so he just configures it with his features. With a make, he compiles it, and in the end, he runs make install to install and deploy it on his machine. So now let's take a look how you write this stuff, which is this talk about. So first, we need to write the configure.ac, which takes care of configuration of your project, checking for libraries, checking for enabled features, and things like that. Contrary from that, there is a automake, which takes care of describing your libraries and the source code which it's using and similar. So first, the configure.ac. Now, if you all have the laptops, please open the first tinyURL. This is showing the, I'll hopefully open it. This is a simplified autogen sh file, which I showed on the command before. And it's actually pretty complex, as you can see. Because it's written in backward compatible way, so it runs almost everywhere from systems from 2002 to current ones. You also can decide not to care at all about older systems, and for that, the solution is, let me try to switch back, just run autoreconf ve. The V is verbose, E is install. Install just copies the files from your system into the project directories where it was set up in the configure.ac. So What does it actually do, the AutoGem? It runs libtoolize, which handles libraries, run aclocal, which handles headers, automake, which handles the make compilation, and autoheader, and autoconf. And these all are merged into the command in the presentation, autoreconf verbose. Install. Louder? Text? It's maximalized. I can put it on full screen. Font. Give me a second. Larging. Better? Okay. So, as you can see, and you opened the URL yourself, I hope, we are using this on CBugzilla project, which is just tiny, small project. I helped my friend to write last month or so, 2 months ago, actually. So, yeah, this is actually currently working and in production. What? How it should work with Bugzilla? CBugzilla works with novel Bugzilla, as one guy asks. And CBugzilla is written to run just statistics, so it's not at all part of our presentation. So let's practice further. So configure AC. It's a large file where you define all the variables. So is somebody coming in, or what's the plan? Okay, doesn't matter. So as you can see, in the file you need to define multiple sections, and I try to split it up. So first, we need to set which autoconf version we need. So that's the first line, AC prereq. It's pretty mandatory to have in the file. It's pretty mandatory to have in the file, and as you can see, we are requesting the version 265. The syntax of the file is always the same. You have some variable, like the AC prereq here on the top, and you just put into normal brackets the data you want to insert, and if you want to protect them, like they are normal string, nothing to expand, you put them again into the, I don't know, what's this name of these brackets? The other one. Square brackets, I guess, okay. So let's call them square brackets. Then you need to init your package, basically define the version, Bugzilla links, and everything. It's the command ac init. There you define the name, which creatively in this example we call package, and define version. The m4 esys command executes commands from your system, so we have a version sh script, which kind of produces our version string. I will show this later on, how this works, because nowadays I am too lazy to define the version myself. So I let JIT use this, and I run the script, and it determines whether it's JIT version, tag version, and automatically fill it up, so I don't have to care about this file anymore. Then you need to configure the macro dir. What's the macro dir? Macro dir is the location where you put your own scripts. Anything that's written in the configure AC can be rewritten as a M4 macro, which basically this is M4 language. So the macro is syntax is similar, and we will see later on how does it look, because I have some examples there. Configure your headers. Usually most projects use only config ha and nothing fancy. So just config headers, config ha. It's nice to have the config ha because it provides the default values for GNU definitions, version information, package name, and you can later on use it all over your project and not to have to define it yourself anywhere. Yes, Ankur? Could you guys give him some microphone so he is on the... So let's wait a bit so he gets a mic or something. Oh, we have only one mic. Okay, that's a bit bummer. Okay.
Okay, is the square bracket is only for avoid expansion of the macro?
Yeah, the square bracket is something like quoting protection you would use in Bash.
The AC init is calling M4 AC command.
Uh-huh.
After the last PC version, again, you are calling M4 AC command. I can support
No, 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 you don't want to expand it. It would be something like eval. And in this case, we want only to call the command with the plain string version sh. It's not expanded at all. The first m4ss command just executes, and you put as a regular string the what execute. Nothing to expand, basically. That's why it's in the square brackets.
The square bracket does ask about the function.
Yeah, the question is if the square bracket doesn't avoid the function call, and yes, it doesn't avoid any function call. If it's in the before with the m4ss command, it actually is a call for the command, and the version sh is just the argument for this this function to execute. Okay, so let's proceed. So, config ha. Yeah, so after you did this, you have to init your automake. Automake handles the dependencies, it handles the headers, C files, whatsoever is needed in your project, what is to install, how to install, where to install. Config only checks for the dependencies and options. So, in this special case, we define some minimal version, which is 1.11 in this case. It's the latest version, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe now, not. No, now is 1.13.4. Okay, it doesn't matter. Basically, this is the, you should usually set this variable to something that's known to be working. Whether it's what you have on system or whether somebody confirms you older version, it doesn't matter. But basically, it's safer always to put what you have on your system to ensure it works for everybody who tries to run it. Then there is a definition of foreign. There are two possibilities for this variable. It's foreign or GNU, and it defines some specific variables for GNU projects. So unless your project is a GPL, GNU stuff, you probably want foreign. Then there are two variables for nodedist, GZ, and distxz, and they define the makedist behavior, and makedist create you the turbol when you install, when you want to deploy for download. So nodedist.js surprisingly says, do not provide me GZ turbol, like something something dot tar dot GZ, and distxz, surprisingly, the other way around, requires something something tar dot xz. Next option is silent rules. That's a fancy one for developing, but not really loved by packagers, because it hides all the compilation status and reports and shows only warnings and errors. So you have it really, really pretty. I will take a look if I manage to have it here. Give me a second to look. I hope I have the clone here. Nah. It should. Ah, okay. I don't have it here. Basically, the make only prints out like CC space name of the C file. CC space name of the C file new line. Instead of printing GCC dash options dash header includes dash something output C file. So it's shorter and easier to spot your warnings. But on the other hand, distributors usually want to see that. But they can override themselves, so this is a pretty good variable when you are developing something and see it. Then you define basically what language your package is. Usually ACLang C or ACLang C++. Later on you can specify you want more languages like Perl whatsoever. But this is just the overall definition. It just defines more stuff you would then have to do by hand, by multiple calls, so this is shorter. And I put there variable PC version, which is a package version for package config. It has a bit different syntax than AC init for the version string storing. And as I'm lazy, as I said, so I use the same command to generate the version for package config, just with different arguments. We will take a look on that script later on, so don't worry. Version is our script, see? So you can all open it. Let's see if it loads. Oh, huge license as is. And basically, you get some package version, which checks if the, as you can see, I will put it on the first line, we check if a directory.git is around, and if it's so, you can try to describe the git version, which is git describe always, which is the set which puts you in six characters from a hash of the commit you have in the git. And if there are some commits in the git itself, it appends dirty. So you can have a version like, here. Let me enlarge it. You can have a version like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is version of your package. It's completely garbage for anyone, but for you as a developer, you'll see exactly the commit you care about. And this happens only for a git version. Here it is back. And if there is file version, which we generate by makedist, we will see that later, we put the content of such file into the version string. If we are unlucky with everything, we call it unknown, which is just fallback. If you ever get terrible with version unknown, somebody will want to kill you. So try not to get to this point. Then we define SO version, which is SoName version, and we will talk about this later on when we talk about libtool, libraries handling. And then we just define how we use the versioning. If there is no argument, we set package version. If there is some argument, the P, we separate this version with dots for package config. If V, we separate it with, how is this called, this character? Semicolon is the, no, colon, yes. So colon, and we separate this for subversion, which is libtool later on to see. So then we need to find for our program some application and libraries we will need for deployment. So we are writing C99 application because we pitted people with CNC from 89. So let's define that. The variable is like this, and you really don't have to remember it. Basically, copy it from other projects which already define it. Again, we need some C preprocessor, which is proc cpp. We will install the package, so we need install command. We will create some symlinks, so ln s-s for symlinks. I don't know why I put there make set, because I probably copied it from somewhere, so it's not needed so much in most of your applications, but it doesn't hurt. And then we are going to use package config. Just out of the curiosity, who of you know what package config is? Or other ways around, since nobody's raising here. Who doesn't know what package config is? Okay, everybody is looking confident, so I suppose everyone knows package config. So we set some version for package config, here 0.20. For package config, the important thing is to set the correct version you want. Older package configs had serious problems when you worked with cross-compilation. It was fixed, I think, in version 0.18. And any version after that can handle cross-compilation from x86 to ARM and things like that in one hood. So you should be safe. That's why I everywhere put 20, because I like round numbers. Then, as we found package config, we know our package will need some libraries. In this case, we want curl. We call it package check modules. And we define that name of a checked output. So this it will be prefixed with curl underscore. So in this prefix, we are looking for libcurl. And when it's done, the output outputs these two variables. Curl cflux and curl libs. Curl cflux contains the includes, definitions, whatever is needed to provide by the curl library. And curl libraries contains the libraries. So content for cflux is something like e user include blah blah nullaf 0.4, and this is cflux. And for libs, something like link Sure. So the L the L something contains the library without the lib prefix for somebody who doesn't know. So we check for the curl with this and XDG, which is some libxdg based dir. I just copied it from one of the projects, so I don't know what libxdg based dir actually does, but we might need it, so let's put it there. You can actually store everything directly into the lib variable, but I don't like that. I prefer if you later on specify per binary what exactly are the needed libraries and needed cflux, rather than forcing all the parts of your project to use the same libraries and same cflux. If you, for example, provide four libraries in one project, you would link everything with everything, which is slightly overkill, we can say. And this is faster if you do it correctly. Even with as needed, it is faster this way. Then, of course, not all projects provide us with fancy stuff like package config, because they think making your life miserable is better. So you have to check for the headers, for example, and for libraries. Usually, these commands are, again, easiest to copy outside from some existing project or examples, because you don't have to remember the syntax, but usually it is. Something you are checking for is the first variable, for this time, buffer your tidy age. So that's what we are looking for. Then we have a what to store in the case it was successful, and what to do if it fails. Now, question arises. Why the hell am I not putting anything into successful mode? We should store it somewhere, right? Not really, because these variables are annoying, and they store everything into direct cflux and direct libs. So it gets stored directly for all the applications to use. That's why I prefer to write package config for the libraries I have to use and return them to upstream, so you don't have to bother with this and make it actually cleaner. For the libraries, it's a bit more complex because the syntax is a bit shifted, but in the end you see research tidy library, return code, if positive, if negative, we error out. But what's the first argument? It's a function we are searching in the library. So this way you can ensure that, for example, you are looking for a tidy library, which is newer than something, which added the function. You just name the function in the search libs, and it will search for it. Again, it is much more better to describe in the package config, like here. But if you don't have any chance, this is the way how to do it. Bit of water. Now we get to the important part. This is how you handle the configuration switches, feature on, feature off. And why the hell I call it automagicness? Automagicness means that if nobody specified any parameter like with foo, without foo, it's on. It tries to search for the library, and if it doesn't find it, it just disables the feature. But if, in case the developer, the consumer specified with the library that he wants it, it bails out and dies and says, okay, you said you want the library foo, but you didn't give me the library foo, and stops the build. So this makes the quick deployment easy, because we just run configure and everything is detected automatically. But if you want to fine grind yourself, for example, you have some ugly library on your system, and you don't want this package to use this ugly library, so you just run it without the library, and it won't search for it. The syntax is a bit scary. What the hell is it? The as if is a conditional, like if in bash. Actually, the syntax in the first brackets is sh syntax, because all M4 macros are later on expanded to sh script in the configure. So as we have here the as if something, so we can also write it like if test the variable. This is the line as if, as we see here. You can write it as normal condition if you don't like the M4 macros. Actually, I like M4 macros, that's why I write them like this. So, anybody doesn't understand how this logic works in the automagicness stuff? I guess it's pretty straightforward. You check for if wistful is not specified. If not, you just check for it automatically and set to no if it's not found. Otherwise, if have foo is specified as yes, you check for it too, and then if it's not set, like found, you error out that you didn't find it. And v-error. V-error is c-flag, or cxx flag, depends on where you put it, and it ensures that whenever compilation finds warning in your source code, it dies, it stops the build, which is perfect for development. But nightmare for, again, for any packager, because they might update glibc, GCC, whatsoever, and suddenly there are new warnings you didn't anticipate in your program. So you have to provide a way how to disable it. You can even put it enabled as default, which is here acarg enable, which is in that case dash dash enable something, in this case v-error. And in the help string, you describe it. And I forgot to say it here, but never mind. AS help string also, with the first variable, sets the default value. If it's without or disable, the opposite is used as default value. So if you say here, disable v-error, default value for this configure switch is enable v-error. Same case here, we specified help string without foo. The default value for this is with foo when you run configure without any parameters. Then you simply check if it's enabled and append to cflux the v-error, plus you set your own cflux which you want to set everywhere. I'm a bit insane, so wow, extra pedantic, lets you, you can ruin your life fixing these warnings. Yeah. So basically with these steps we done now, like define the version and set the automake configuration, find the libraries, configure some options. We are actually getting to the stage where we are ready to deploy the makefile, which is, again, easy. You configure some files, makefile in and my library PC. Both of them are parsed from the .in file you have somewhere in the repo. The PC file, basically, contains the classical content like user lib64. Let's see. Wow, too many. So let's see, xcb something. So we have, you have a PC file, but instead of variables here like the libs, cflux, you have a merda. You have content like this. You can put more. Oh, some libs. Lib2, etc, etc. And the version is also, the, for example, or we had a PC version, if I remember, so PC version. I wrote the two syntax there, as you can see, one is the normal dollar bracket, and the second one is the at syntax. Both are interchangeable. I prefer the at one because it's shorter. At least it looks better. And it's more visually separated from other bash variables. Because if you have something like this, and put there bash variable, it's pretty confusing to figure out which one is which. So I rather prefer the at syntax. The at syntax is used in all in files used by the system. Then you say the AC output. It actually prints out the output to the files like config status, which reports the status failed, passed with the content of the configure. It provides config log, which is of course log what it was doing and checking for. And there is also another file which I just forgot, and it contains errors extra. And then I love to put at the bottom of my configuration file the notice about what did you configure. It's nice just for the visual confirmation what's on the output. In this case, we put only the v-error, So just build configuration and what's the content of the VR variable in our script. Ta-da, and we see it. I have to find the cbugzilla, so I start the find here. Actually, to hell with it. Do you know, guys know Mosh? It's SSH alternative, pretty fast, pretty cool. Arc, open source, cbugzilla. Oh, come on, where are you? Ah, you see, pp. This is also one of my projects, so let's see, configure. And we are running configure for this one. So let's give it a few seconds to see what's the actual output. It checks for various options we defined there. See, and this is the build configuration I was saying. This is the default values we had because we didn't pass any arguments. So Amiga is disabled, debug is disabled, so let's try to enable debug. And it triggers again. Suddenly this is stupid system, so it every time runs all again and again and again. See, now debug is, yes, it's the third line. You all can see now yes, before it was no. So this is the configure script. It checks for the libraries and options you want to enable. Nothing else. It can do nothing else. Actually, it can if you try to destroy it or use it how it's not supposed to. But this way, it's actually much, much cleaner. So don't do nothing else apart from searching for libraries and checking the options. It doesn't belong in this file, even if it's possible, and some examples will show you. Now, for the M4 macros. This is example from LibreOffice macro. And it's check for the extension system we have there. It provides the configure option, which is enable ext something, which is argument for our call, which looks like this. I should probably open some editor, I think. Let's see if Cabrite can handle my awesomeness in this presentation. So libo check feature. So argument was name of the feature. So for example, flying cats, whatever. It's just a name to describe in configure. Then some build type. I don't know what that is. So let's call it fast. Then you have a third argument, which is a... Oh, it's mixed up here. I didn't notice. It should be only three arguments. So as you can see on second line and on the inner if condition, there is collision with enable ext. Oh, I now know what's the problem. There is multi-line switches like fast solver, which is a feature. And you can't put that into the second conditional because everything that's in the enable with the dashes, like here we have the enable switch fast resolver. It gets converted to variable enable fast resolver. So everything gets underscored. So you can store it into the same variable. So you pass it as, oh, here it is, as two. And let me put some enters so it's visible for everyone. Fast resolver. And for last. And you have the call for the feature. You don't have to specify the configure switch. You don't have to specify the build type and everything. What are the rest of the stuff in this macro? You define the function, put there the configure switch, then you print out the message, like when we run, oh, here. When we like the checking whether a C compiler works, yes. Checking for C compiler default output file name, A out, and things like that. So you want your checking message, what are you actually doing, so user knows what you are doing. So for building the extension. And then, later on, based on yes or no, you say result yes, result no, and output some variable, which is AC substitute. The AC substitute makes the variable available in other scripts used by AutoMake and so on. So without this line, which should be actually needed even in the package config checker, you wouldn't be able to use the curl, cflux, curl libs anywhere in the makefile. The new package check modules does it for you, because package check modules is, no surprise, M4 macro like this. Like this. And it contains AC subst, $1 and the dash cflux, $1 dash libs. And that's for macros. They can be really complex and you can write anything there. Most useful use case is actually just reducing the repetitive tasks you have in your configure. Don't try to use them for something else too much. Rather, if you have to, for example, write a huge M4 macro to detect some library, it's much more better to get in touch with the library provider, developers, whatsoever, and convince them to provide the PC file for you. Much, much faster and easier for your brain than writing these M4 functions. For the scare, we can take a look on here. I don't see URL bar here. Okay, like this, and let's take a look. M4. Boost is a library for C++ that provides extensions to stdlib, and if we manage to load it, I can show you why M4 macros can be evil. Not that the M4 macro is wrongly written, it's written really cleanly and understandably, but it's not exactly the best tool on the world for these tasks. And we seem not to have the internet right now. Is it working for you, anyone, guys? Just Googling boost M4 and clicking on the link? Okay. Let's try the other. Nope. It seems maybe GitHub has a problem. Okay, this is a... Oh, this is old fork of it. So, we don't care. And this is the M4 macro for boost. So let's put it a bit larger. Is it enough? Large enough for everybody? So as you can see, you have M4 define and eval there and all the fancy stuff, counting to 1,000 lines just to check for boost libraries, instead of 7 PC files, which would substitute this. Because boost provides 7 libraries, if I'm right, 7 or 8, something like that. Instead of that, rather, let's write 1,000 lines of codes. That's not optimal at all. You can do it, but you shouldn't. Now, AutoMake. That's the easy task. Because you just will be now the machine which says what C files you have, what headers you have. This should be scanned by autoscan, which is a command that scans your project and tries to generate most optimal configure and make files. Never works for me. So you can try it. I won't deny you from so, but it's easier to write from scratch. So make files have one rule. You have to write them non-recursive. This means you have a source there of your project. For example, we had here the UC. UCPP package. Okay, like this, it's more readable. UCPP package, and we have one configure AC, nothing else, and one makefile arm. There, in any other folders like SRC, I should change my defaults. There is only a few files, but no makefile. Basically, you try to put everything into the root makefile. And why is that? Why should I impose you this ugliness to make the makefile really huge? The problem is with parallelization. A makefile is really not recursive safe. So the more makefiles you use within your project, like for each dir one, it has to be sourced, and all the dependencies has to be checked. So it slows with each file more and more and more. And we had some measures, but I was unable to find them because we did them like 5 years ago. But it was in like 30% speed up if you use a non-recursive make file on 12 jobs. So if you have a really huge build bot with 60 jobs, you can imagine it can be even faster because of how much time it loses for the recalculating all the dependencies again and again and again instead of compiling in more threads. As you are writing the file in the top directory of your project, it's actually easier to write because you don't have to handle things like include was in the directory 3 levels down or 4 levels down. But you just do includes equal. Actually, that you don't have to specify src there because it's default, so just. And you are set. You don't have to ever bother with the dots and where to go next. Now, how does the file look? Let's start from the top. This is the generic declarations we should always use. Oh, one is extra there, doesn't matter. So we set AC local variables. It includes the directory where we put the M4 files, which should be equal to the content we put there, here, the AC config macro there. It's the same macros and they can be used in makefile too. So basically, you don't have to set it for M4. You can say it's, for example, blue configure settings, whatsoever. The only important thing is to have it same in both of these declarations. I prefer M4. Some projects use AUX build. Basically, make it understandable for others which will try to hack on your system. Then I put the here AMLD flux option, which actually should be in the section for libtool, but I can explain it right now. And this ensures that when linking library, it ensures that no symbols are unresolved during that time, which also fails build if you are missing some library and you didn't notice, if it's not called directly. Then we set up the package config installation, which is the also variable definition for directory and for the data. Package config is predefined, but you can invent all your other means how to do it. For example, oh, come on, delete. What did I use here? Package config, so. Data user data so you define my data directory which points to user data my package and my data data which is the content of the you want to put into the user data my package. So we are putting there ugly picture PNG. It doesn't matter for the path you are using for the data here. It gets always resolved to the last section, so only the file gets put there without the path. So later on it's user data ugly picture PNG. No, it gets stripped down. It's not used. That's why you can use it from the top SRC there. If it were not ignored, you would actually have to move everything into the root folder of the project, which would kind of kill the potential use for this. So after that, you have to, if it's not an internal variable like the package config, which is predefined, you have to put it into the variable extra dist, which is extra distributed files from your project. For example, you can provide the PC in, which is not used elsewhere. Some extra blob, the my variable. In this case, it would be my data data, the content of the data variable. And we provide the dot version and version sh, which are the content for the version sh script we seen earlier. When I'm looking at this, basically in extra dist you need to name everything that's not directly related with compilations, like headers or C files, because if it's not used by the auto tools, it's not installed and provided by makedist. Even if you have an install target like we did here, with the MyData, it won't be distributed into the tarball unless you say so. It's pretty stupid. I would rather prefer if it was automatic, but you have to name all these in the extra dist variable. That's one thing to remember. But actually it's good, because when you run the make check for the distribution of the tarball, it stops you and says you, okay, it's not possible to compile this when we are distributing, we are lacking these files. So it's easy to fix. Then we need to compile some binary. Again, pretty straightforward. There is a variable bin programs. Bin means the location where it's put. So in this case, user bin. If it would be sbin programs, do you have any area where it should go? Anybody? Where should sbin programs will end up? What's the difference between sbin programs and bin programs? Pretty straightforward. Bin programs go to user bin, sbin programs go to user sbin for the root. That's probably the only locations where you ever should put your binaries, unless you are crazy. Then you define the names of the applications. Here we have only one, but we can name all of them, like A, B, C, D, something and something else. And you basically can name all the binaries you are going to provide with your application on one line or slash separated like the sources are we have here. Then for each binary, you should specify cflags and ldadd. Cflags are the cflags like includes, defines provided by external packages, local includes, local defines, whatever you want to pass there. And ldadd is libraries adding. So in this case, we have a binary, which was not exactly brilliant from me. So let's try to explain. So you have a bin programs, my app, and then you write my app sources equals something C, and you are set. You don't, if it doesn't need any C flags, any libraries, then you are done. This will generate your binary, in this case called my app. Finished. Here we have three source files. The path, of course, as we are starting from the root file, can go anywhere from on the project. And we specify some cflags, our package links to some external package. So external package cflags, and use some internal includes which are somewhere hidden. So include srcdir wherever we want to have the includes. And for linking, we need the external library, and we link to internal provided library, libexample LA. What the hell is LA? That's libtool extension, libtool archive. SRCDIR of the makefile itself you are running it from. If we are using the only the top project makefile, SRCDIR is equal to top underscore SRCDIR. But you don't have to use it. The SRCDIR is not needed here. You could also write it like E. And it will be exactly the same like writing. It's equal. I just like to have variables where they're supposed to be because I don't forget what I did. Especially for the includes, it makes more sense when you then have a verbose output, you see what's happening. Why the hell am I using the internal library like libexample.la? Because we are using libtool, which we will describe later on, for libraries creation. We need a libtool archive to link to our library, so we don't have to care whether we are linking to the shared or static one, but it's decided by build system. Actually, did I? Yeah, we will see that later on. What am I speaking about? And then we need to add some headers. So again, some include there. For example, we here have lib example. Again, creative me. So we define some include there. Include there is obviously the path to user include, unless overridden. And all the headers are again put directly into the folder you named here. So it doesn't matter what path you specified in libexample include headers, like here the libexample / something. It will be installed directly into the libexample here folder here as example h, not into double libexample folder. And one extra thing for header, sometimes we have internal headers for our project we don't want to distribute. So we just define noinst headers, which are headers that are not installed. This is a predefined macro. So we have some. As you can see, I can't type, so the last line on the slide is again typoed. So, tests. That's the another part of your application you should all do. Everyone should write tests. Even if you don't want to, you should. There is a specific underscore programs pattern, which is check programs. Like we showed previously, the bin programs go to bin, sbin programs go to sbin. You don't want to install your tests. Nobody should do that. So that's why we provide the new target, check the programs. Again, we have a test creatively called test as an application, and you define it as a normal binary. So you cflux, ldflux, sources, and that's it. Test ldflux, the no install here, actually ensures that when linking to local libraries, you are not installing it, so it doesn't have to check for the symbols and tools. To strip the symbols and everything, and thus ensures you can GDB directly in yourselves there, the tests, failing tests, instead of running the make and having to have the library installed. Because without this option, if you would be debugging some application and it wouldn't be installed on your system at the moment, you wouldn't see the trace unless the no install is specified here. Oh, I forgot one variable. The second line is test equal test. The test's content can be any SA scripts, Python scripts, the binary commands, and it basically, after the compiling of all the check programs, it in parallel executes various content of the tests. So you can write tests test and a.sh, and the tests then after the test would be compiled would run sh and test binary, so it gets executed. Some of the tests can be only compilation tests, so you don't want to execute them, but if you have some output or execution, you need to name them in tests extra. So now we have a defined default setting for automake, create some binary, included some headers, and we have a test. So I suppose we are pretty set for having working build system. Not really, I forgot on custom rules. You can also redefine any phase, because AutoTools has various phases, like clean, install, who, so distribute, and so on. So I prefer to have a reduced version, which I put in each of my projects, a disk clean local, which is basically local make clean extra content. So I remove some cache files, some temporary files, vim temp files, whatsoever you want to remove. Then I have a dist hook, which is a hook for make dist command, and it ensures I generate the change log. from JIT commit log. So I don't have to bother to describe what the hell did I did, but first the people read it. And the last part is a helper for the version sh script, which actually generates the version based on the tag of the you are doing it from. So for example, you had on your system something like git tag is 001 and run this check, it would generate tarball myapp 001 tar exit, and in that tarball would be again the folder myapp 001 dot version, which would contain exactly the content of this tag, so 001. And this is how I avoid having to change the configure scripts every time I do a new version, which saves me shitload of time. The JIT hook looks pretty scary, but it's just I want to have it pretty. Let me take a look. I have it maybe here. Nope. Okay, so no pretty lock, because I don't remember where I put it. But basically, you can only run JIT log to changelog or something, or even say no changelog pipe to changelog and be done with it. So now the ugly part, handling libraries. This is where most projects in current open source world suck a lot because they don't have it right. Little versioning. I tried to describe this because every time I looked on this, I did it wrong. That's why I wrote the version sh script, which handles it for me. But these are the rules you should obey when you have a lib tool and you try to soname version your library. So if you could please all read it so I don't have to repeat myself, and just ask questions if you have some for this. I will wait a few seconds. Basically, the rule is to ensure that without this, your version information about your library is not complete. And when you have distributions which rely on your libtool versioning, they can actually trigger rebuilds of a dep tree based on your changes for the versioning of this variable. For example, if you bump the revision, nothing happens. But if you increment current, you obviously need to recompile the package. And if you bump the age, you actually don't that much, because nothing breaks, but it's also better to recompile. So you can have a dependency solver, for example, for build service, which only checks the libtool versioning. And only in the case that current or age changed, you have to trigger a rebuild of the dep tree. Otherwise, you don't care because it's just revision, so bug fixes, and you don't have to recompile anything. But given the fact that most upstreams don't follow this scheme or actually set this to their version number, you have to recompile everything, which is time consuming and completely needless. So how the libtool versioning is actually done? You add the three lines to configure AC. You set the libtool version. Again, we are lazy bastards, so we use the version sh script I wrote and just let the content flow in it. Then init the package libtool. I disable directly static libraries and enforce the pick mode. I hope I won't explain what pick mode is. But disable static is pretty obvious. There won't be any static libraries provided. For the pick, I can point you to nearest hardening explanation for your package. And maybe if you, just maybe, this is the third line is not mandatory. Just only if you call libtool somewhere directly. You, for example, have some extra command which runs the libtool. You need to check for the program itself if it's around. libraries, they are almost the same like the other, like the binaries. So we have, again, special macro underscore altl. Let me delete everything here. Special macro altl libraries, and you specify lib, libexec. And again, it's where it gets put. If it's libexec, it's user libexec. And if it's lib, user lib. Or if you are on 64-bit system, user lib64. And if you have a new Google toolchain, user lib x32, if I'm right, I'm not sure now. Something like this is for the new x32 architecture. So again, we define the library. Here is the problem, because it's not the directly library. We need to provide the suffix .la for each library we provide. So it's libtoolarchive. So for every name of the library, you just append the .la. And again, you specify the sources, cflags, and this is a problem, especially when you do lots of copy-pasting. It's ldflux, not ldadd like for the binary, but you have to specify ldflux for libraries. Don't ask me why, I don't remember, but it's the way how we have to live. So we use cflux and libs from some external package. Then you set the, then we set the version info, as we were talking about here in the libtool versioning, to something sane. And the most important part for the crazy users is the export symbol regex. It actually ensures that you export only symbols you want. For example, in your library, you want to have as a part of your public interface only foo underscore something. So you set export symbols regex only for the foo underscore libraries. And thus, you don't pollute the symbol namespace. If it's called namespace, I'm not now sure. For example, without this regex, there was some clash in Enlightenment, which took 3 years to fix, because nobody was aware why it's failing on some systems, because two libraries provided the same symbol without any prefixing. And the generic name, of course. So. Okay, that, so we have libraries, and we have everything. So let's try to write a build system. Actually, how are we on the time? So we are half an hour in the workshop. Splendid. Perfect timing. So as I said, I will waste you for a half hour, and now we start to do some fun. So this is a Michal Zrušecký library. He really wished to convert to AutoTools. So let's try for the internet and pray it works. Oh, GitHub is down, right? No, please work. Perfect. There should be clone URL. Oh, for everybody, if you could open the address I will now dictate. Dev, gentoo, experimental, .org/tilde/scarabeus. And at the bottom, you can see the PDF called OSC AutoTools Workshop. That's the presentation I'm now giving, and it contains the examples we were doing. So now when we will be talking about how to write the build system, you all can look into it as a cheat sheet. So try to download it. I would like to enlarge it some more. Oh, I can write it into the here. So the file OSC AutoTools, I don't know what I put there. And we download the sucks in the meantime. Copy that. Oh, here we can do it. So let's clone and see if it works. So let's take a look what Michal actually have in the Sachs library. I actually don't know if he already started or not. Nope, he has some doxy file, which is a doxygen configuration for documentation, and CMake. And he obviously wants to migrate to AutoTools because it's his choice, so don't hassle him for it. What's the CMake actually doing? CMake lists. Nothing. It checks for AUGUS, libUI, and installs some library and adds subdirectory SRC. So what's in SRC? Now I am a bit scared. Okay, some includes. Ah, that's horribly written, CMake. Okay, so let's get rolling and let's write our build system. You will save this as config.ac and start with the checkings they have in the CMake. Workshop sucks. Because I am also a lazy guy, how was the library called we were messing with before? UCPP? Let's copy the script we already have pre-prepared. Why is it wrong? Wrong path. Now we have the autogen sh, and we didn't move a finger. This is how you write AutoTools, just copy out from the all the projects. Nobody would be willing to write it from scratch at all, ever. So we have the autogen, and now let's start with the initialization. Where should we steal this from? I have the source code for the presentation, so let's use that one. Font in the, like this?
Yes.
Sorry, so now we can see where we are. And let's steal the content of my presentations. So presentations, OSE AutoTools workshop, and we have plenty of TXT files here. So autoconf initialization, I guess, is our starter. Let's copy this and let's discuss how it's supposed to be done. So commentary we don't need. Init sucks 3. As I am a lazy guy, I will put this later on. So we don't need to define the version, but let's check what version is used there. What tags? 0.1.1. So let's expect the new version to be 0.1.2. We have a macro there, we will have config. Automake init is always the same. It's silent rules are always useful. And is it actually C or C++? It's C++. So we have to change the variable C++. And they don't provide package config yet, so that will be needed to be written later on. So now we have a config.ac base, and we will write makefile mbase. Again, let's make it larger. And for makefile m, I think I have the code too. Automake. Include no, sources no, default values. Voila, let's just steal this stuff and don't care like there is no tomorrow. So we have an autogen file and that's it. We didn't see any package config file and that's it. So this is our minimal subset. It obviously won't do anything apart from distribute the autogen sh file.
Uh,
it will be created by the autogen. It's created by the autogen sh script, and if it, you don't have the script, the autoreconf dash v is verbose, and dash e, small e is install, and that install ensures that everything is pre-created, like mkdir, m4, and things like that. We can actually try it when I say, did I save it? Oh, hell, I hope so. Make phylum, yes. So let's go to our sucks folder and try to compile it. So as we said, developer's approach is autogen it. Where is the autogen? Aha. I didn't want to copy it. Now we have it here. So autogen does the scans. Ah, the result configure. Well, never mind. We actually can distribute anything. So just remove the option, no this GZ. Then, let's try again. Ah, okay, so it won't allow us to do this because we are not configuring the files which we showed at, as the last slide, the AC output. So we are not outputting any files, and it doesn't like that we are just doing configure and nothing comes out of it. So let's put the AC output there and we will be fine. Auto results. Sadly, I have to reinstall this laptop before this talk, and I am missing some features like a normal setting for copy and paste and similar, so it's pretty limiting. Actually, we can even keep the notice because we will add the V error later on, I guess. So now, like this, not close. As you can see, AutoMake is Auto tools are generating loads and loads of status in status files in our folder. So if we run a JIT status, wrong folder, JIT status, we can see that there is some make file m which we didn't done, obviously that's our tool, but AC local m4 automake automation cache config h in install sh lt main for lib tool. M4, and in M4 there is more for libtool, I guess. Yeah, libtool stuff. Everything prefixed with LT is something you don't want to touch. And the missing. The missing is output for the lost and found, if I'm right. If something is missing when you run the allocal autoconf automake, then this is called and prints out X is missing in your project. So let's try again. Oh, come on, disappear. So now we finished the autogen. Now the configure should actually work, even if it does nothing. So let's take a look. Configure. It checks for C++, and we are done. That's what we specified in the project. And it creates the make file, config h file, and we can actually do even make this right now, but let's take a look into config h so we know what it actually contains. It has the package name, it has the version here, some tarball name, bug report URL that can be also defined on the AC init line we had here. So here we can do we are really friendly upstream, so let me put it larger. We don't want your bug reports. It should actually not compile right now when I'm thinking of it because I have a apostrophe there and it should not be correctly expanded by how to make, but let's try it. Every time you change those two files, you have to regenerate. See, so it passed, but he doesn't like it and prints warning that it's not literal, whatever that means. So again, configure. Yeah, so it fails later on because it expanded the variable somewhere. This is why you have to pay attention even to the warnings to the of the configure autogen scripts. So let's not care about the bug reports right now and proceed with our application. If I checked correctly, SAX tool itself requires two package config modules, AUGEAS and libui. Any suggestions how we should add this to our lovely project? Check for the package config support, yes, and and then check the package config file per the library, yes. Actually, you can be a lazy guy and just create one package config call and search for all the libraries you want. But I like it to be separated because that's easier how to catch when you missed something somewhere. Yeah, packages will definitely appreciate that if you check it in separate steps. So let's again be lazy guys and just steal it from the presentation slides. It's autoconf, what could it be? Apps detection, I suppose. Yes. So we will be installing it, so let's just steal the whole set. Completely, come on. Copy. And paste. Make set is completely useless for our case. So it was libuie, if I'm right. Epsilon UI, okay. What a name, what a name. And how should we call it? EUE, oh, so sweet. And the other library was AUGEAS. Yeah, this is bad, readable. So now we check for libui and AUGEAS. Again, we save it and we roll back to configure this stuff. Actually, it will fail this time because I made sure there is no AUGEAS and libui on the system. So let's see what happens. It will scream like a lot. See, libui, we don't have libui. You won't have your application this time, mate. So let's install those. Bigger. Crawling up. Now readable. I suppose it's devel. Yes, devel. This is OpenSUSE. Ah. I'm lazy and I love sudo. Nobody ask. Nobody make funny faces on me. So let's wait on our zipper to get it installed. And in the meanwhile, let's take a look on the source code we have in SAX. There seems to be SRC folder and some man page. I hope it's pre-generated. Yes, it is. Even easier for us. And we have some UE files, whatever it is. Oh, so everything is just C++ with, oh, resources. What are those? Usage. Why are the resources put into the resources? Okay. So it's some images used by the application. So we will install those as extra files, which we can, oh, install. Thank you. Which we can do right away in the auto make. So sax data font, sorry, sax data, and we put there the images itself. It's important to be precise with your tabbing, whether you decide to use spaces or use tabs, but don't mix it in the files, ever. It breaks like Python, for example. Simply use one or the other, never the mixture. So sax data, and what were the variables? Oh, it's installed, so. So it's SRC, RS, keyboard, monitor, mouse, touchpad. We will define the variable, the location for it, and then put it to extra dist. Monitor. And we have to, this is nice. As you can see, the gate is at least nice enough to tell me that I forgot the backslash, so it's black. Ah, monitor, ah. I can't type, I can see, okay. Keyboard, monitor, what were the others? Mouse and touchpad. See, I wrote mouse correctly. And that's it. Sucks there. There, that really sucks. So where should we put it in the... And we are done, I suppose. Data there is a specified variable. Like libdir is for libraries, datadir is for data, and it's user data. Package datadir, like package libdir, is appending the name of the package. So for example, in this case, it will be user sax3, and there it would put everything. So let's save this. And extra dist, we add our sax data, voila. And let's try to make it again. Oh, here it is. First, let's just try our augash and libui are found correctly. Libui still not found. What? Why? Aha, it didn't find libui. This is OpenSUSE, I made sure. Ah, I am. Yes, user interface. Aha, that's the magic. I would never expect this library to be. Okay. How to mess with somebody who can't type correctly. Yeah, ruin my life with such libraries which are easy to typo and not notice. So now our configure should pass. Yes, we are done for the configure and rolling, which is win-win. As we are lazy, I think we should also put the conf... Ah, let's keep it for the later. We'll have to do the libtool checking and the v-error, but we can do this as a last step. Stop writing me, gentle developers. It's not now the good time. So nothing for this. And in makefile, we have a sax data. So we did a configure to test it. We need to reconfigure because we changed the makefile. And now we even don't have to run the configure because it gets executed automatically in the make phase. OK, it compiled. No biggie because we didn't compile anything. So let's try install. Let's install it into TMP. Okay, install was completed. No errors. And now if we zoom in again and go to TMP, user local data share data, no, sucks. we see it got installed to the shared SUCKS 3. So it's a package data folder. So we are installing the stuff that's defined by CMake over here. Well, it's SRC, RS, CMake lists. So this thing is equal to automake this thing. Basically, basically the same. The only thing here is that Mishka uses glob to expand the star variable, so he doesn't have to name the files. But I always find it better to, you can actually use globs in makefiles too, but it's better to do it this way, because you at least know every time you add something and remove something that it's tracked. And the build fails if it's gone missing suddenly because somebody got haywire and remove extra files from your build. Yes? You don't need to append it. Yeah, that's a good point. You don't need to, but it's always better to provide it so anybody can redo it with his autoconf, automake, and libtool. So if something is broken when you did the autogen for you, they can regenerate, basically. The autogen SH, if we run the JIT status again here, when we close this, as you can see, there are plenty of files with .m4, the m4 folder. That's everything provided by your libtool in this case, but basically we can say autogen, autoconf, and libtool. Okay, autoheader to the config agent. And if any of these applications had a bug, the user later on can just redo the autogen, and these files get replaced with the functioning version for him. So that's why we provide this file. So this, okay, perfect. So now we have the data, and we should also install the man page. This man really sucks. Okay, so it was SRC, man, and I don't remember. SUCKS3.1, okay, even easier. Actually, I'm not. Oh, extra three, yeah, right, so sucks, man. Actually, you can use the numbers even in these declarations, so you can call it SUCKS3 data if you are too pedantic, and I should probably do that, because otherwise I will forget it SUCKS3 in a really fast fashion. Actually, I'm not sure if you have to name the man here, because it's extra macro, not the data, but the man. And it has specified commands, so it probably adds itself to the extra dist. But it never hurts to mention these data files in the extra dist, and it's just one line. It won't kill any kittens or whatsoever. So we have also man page. Autogen. It mostly, there is only one warning now, that we don't have alt in it, which is libtool in it, in config.ac, and we specify the project as libtool based. We will fix this later on. So the goal is to have this output from autogen completely warningless. If you have some warnings, it's better to give them some attention. And make install, let's just find it in history. Make install TMP. Again, everything installed. And my man page doesn't seem to be installed. Why? Now I'm surprised. What did I miss? What did I miss? Work. Larger, 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 larger. Open source. What's using man pages? Lib. CMIS. Okay, when I installed man pages here, I define specified macros like install manpage, which takes the CMS client and install it by hand. But there should be a macro. Why isn't it working? Auto make man install. Google to the rescue. We don't want the. It's not helping. Okay, we'll figure this later on because I don't remember, and Google is giving us actually man pages for automake, which is not helping at all. So back to our compilation. We will need all the output resulting libraries. So here we don't have any libraries. And here we have subdirectory modules D. I didn't notice that one before. User share sucks 3 modules D. What's this folder and what's it supposed to do? Oh, it installs various images, desktop file. Okay. This will be annoying to describe in the automake because we would have to copy one to one. But in the CMake list itself, we have just include directories, libraries, and just one library, which I can see, sucks3 AU UIF. And one program, sucks3. Actually, no, my bad. We have one library, sucks3 IUIF, and ton of executables called sucks3, sucks3 keyboard, sucks3 mouse, sucks3 monitor, and sucks3 touchpad. So let's try acids. This is really weird. What for? He has the lens folder and everything if he's not using it. Really? Desktop AUG, XR AUG, and I don't see. Yeah, there is just a C code, but the .aug files are not used. Well, then the lens folder is not used. God knows what Michal is doing in there. So let's write the executables. Again, let's steal the code because we are lazy. And it's autoconf. No. Just automake sources. So here he only adds the executables and he actually does not. Oh, that's ugly way how to write it. Everything, including the sucks3 UIF, links to sucks3 UIF. So it should supposed to link to itself. How nicely written. So let's try to rephrase it correctly. So our man pages are not distributed for now, but it's not. Why it's doing spaces like this? Okay. Oh, hell. Back. And now again, regular expression. And we want top. Replace all. Voila. So we are providing multiple applications and as they follow, sucks3, sucks3 keyboard, sucks3 what? Mouse, monitor, touchpad. And I'm missing backslash on this line. So let's. So now we have described all the binary programs we are going to install. And we need to do a bit fiddling with specifying sources for each of those. Sucks resources, and if I noticed it were always one file. Keyboard, mouse, monitors, touchpad, okay. So we don't need this. And since Mishka was lazy, we will be lazy too. Just put the content there. We need to add it everywhere. So it was lib, yast UI, cflux, augas, cflux, and the same for the libraries. Come on. Ah, let's not CMake, this is correct. So now we specify that each of our applications will use in cflux, libui cflux and augash cflux, and it will link to libui and augash. So we don't have to specify it per the binary because we are lazy. But we still have to keep here the sucks, add, and we need to put the library here, which will be called, I don't remember, libsucks3uif. And this we need to do for the all the binary programs, so let's copy it out. Monitor, keyboard, mouse. Wrong enter. So as I said, the dashes are translated to underscores, so keyboard. Mouse. Monitor. Oh, mouse again. And I copied not enough. And the last one was touchpad. I don't know if all of these must link to the libsucks, but if it's written in the former CMake file, let's consider it correct. And now the sources. Keyboard. Mouse. Ten minutes remaining. Oh. How so? We are supposed to have to... Okay then, 10 minutes remaining. In that case, we will quickly package the library and try to compile it fast, so we see at least we are producing some output. We can steal again the configuration from the workshop. Automake libtool. I'll just steal this completely. Copy. Paste. libsucks3 yuif. And we have to define all this stuff here. Oh, we don't need cflux. We will need the ELD flux because we don't need those because currently the CMake didn't use the libtool and had no version information for the libtool, so we will just gracefully ignore it. specify the versions. So it's two files. Copy that. Paste that. Useless. And for the automake, we need to check for the lib tool, which is the alt init line we checked earlier. So the alt init is our key currently. Copy. And paste. Now let's try if this at least kinda compiles, because it should. First again, we need to autogen what we wrote. Make file arm, warning variable. Okay, I don't remember the proper name of the LD added content, so it should be maybe imlibs. But since I don't remember it from head, let's just try at least some binaries if they compile by doing this and this, this. Basically, you can define it up there with the proper variable, which I don't remember again. Done. And let's see what it does now. Or specify it per binary. Yeah, now it passed perfectly. I don't know why it printed this. Alt init. What's wrong with alt init? Ah! I was missing one bracket. See, when you miss something, it nukes completely the bash conversion. It's a really fragile system. Yeah, now it's printing nothing and everything passed. So configure, it checks for Augash, checks for the other library, which I forget all the time. And let's try to compile it. My bad. Because we were copying it everything out from the SRC folder with the CMake. We need to prefix everything with SRC. Touchpad, come on. Mouse, keyboard. And again, we need to, I forgot to run the autogen. Well, actually, it doesn't warn you that you didn't run the autogen, but it will use the all the generated files. So if you do some change and forget to run the autogen, it won't work. It will be still executing the old commands. See, now it's compiling. I don't know if it passed, honestly, to be honest. There are some warnings. String constant to char. Oh, such ugly. There is no SRC monitor C. Why? Ah, I remember there was monitors because they can't name all the source code exactly too much. Again, autogen. Make. It skips the stuff that was already compiled because it remembers that. And as you can see, it compiled everything. Everything is clean. So let's try make install as our final step for this presentation to check if at least was something installed. We installed it to TMP. So let's go to the TMP. So there should be user. And this is our installed package. Local, and we have bin, ton of libraries which you are supposed to provide, sucks keyboard, monitor, mouse, touchpad, and libraries, sucks UEF, even with the soname versioning, which is 0.0.0, as its default, because we don't know the correct values. We should also finish this packaging by fixing all the data missing, the man page, the other stuff, but basically this is working build system for the libsux 3 and the binaries. So any questions for this, since we still have like 5-7 minutes? Nobody, no questions? Okay, so for more reading, let's return to the presentation here. I really have to recommend this book. It's for free online. You can find it on Diego's blog, Diego Elio Paterno. And you can also buy it on Amazon for €2, if I'm right. So if you really like to learn AutoTools, consider buying this for €2. It's a really good book. And we and Suzy are looking for new colleagues. So anybody wants to work at Suzy with Aves and me and others, check out the career page or write on jobs.suzy.com, or somehow, if you are a magician, manage to scan the QR code from this presentation. So thank you for your attention.